Hello friends, let us learn about a new topic today in neurology. Till now we have completed about the dementia and Parkinson's disease. I will teach about the stroke at the end of neurology, probably 1 month later, not now. But let us learn about a new topic today, which is ataxic disorders, which are cerebellar disorders. Ataxic disorders. Which are cerebellar disorders, right? So how do you approach to a patient with ataxic disorders? So approach, if you see the patient here presents with gait impairment, number one, and then he presents with unclear speech, or it is also called as scanning speech. And then there is visual blurring, patient presents, these are the clinical presentation. Visual blurring with nystagmus. Why there is visual blurring? That is also due to nystagmus. And then there is hand incoordination. And there are tremor with movement. So these are the major features, clinical features that the patient presents with. All these major generally result from the involvement of cerebellum, that is two pathways. It can be due to the defect in spinocerebellar pathway, or frontopontocerebellar pathway. So because of the defect in these pathways, these causes ataxic disorders. Now, this is true cerebellar ataxia. Always, whenever a person comes with gait disorder, and this, you can say that it is cerebellar ataxia. But there is one more ataxia, which is associated with labyrinthine disease, which is called as labyrinthine ataxia. Right? So this is true cerebellar ataxia. So let us learn what generally happens in labyrinthine ataxia and how do you differentiate both of them, because that is important when a patient comes to you with this disorder. In labyrinthine disease ataxia, the patient presents with, number one, gait disorder, and then there is dizziness and lightheadedness. And perception of movement. So these are the major things which are seen in labyrinthine disease ataxia. So let us differentiate between cerebellar disease and labyrinthine disease ataxia. In cerebellar disease ataxia, first, gait impairment. The gait impairment is seen in both of them, both in cerebellar disease and labyrinthine disease. Now, if you wanted to know nystagmus is seen in cerebellar disease and also in labyrinthine disease. Right? But what is the difference? The major difference is, if you see dizziness and lightheadedness and vertigo, these are seen in labyrinthine disease but not in cerebellar disease, whereas the symptoms like unclear speech and hand incoordination and tremor with movements, so these are majorly seen in cerebellar disease but not in labyrinthine disease. So this is the major difference between cerebellar and labyrinthine disease. So sometimes in cerebellar disease, it is also associated with cerebellar ataxia. It is associated with sensory disturbances, which is called as sensory ataxia. And then sometimes the imbalance will worsen when the imbalance, that is gait imbalances, these will worsen when visual input is removed, that is on closing eyes, because we can't see anything. Then we can we can't see anything because of when we close our eyes, we can't see anything. So at that time, this imbalance symptoms will worsen, right? Sometimes even the weakness of the proximal leg muscles mimics cerebellar disease. So this is about cerebellar ataxia. So let us learn about the different types of cerebellar ataxia. Cerebellar ataxia is majorly of two types. One is symmetric ataxia, which is involving both sides, and progressive ataxia. Other is focal, involving only one, and ipsilateral ataxia. So let us learn about the first one first. Symmetric or progressive ataxia. So this symmetric or progressive ataxia is divided into three types. It can be acute, that is lasting for hours to days, or it can be subacute, which lasts for days to weeks, and then chronic, which is lasting for months to years, right? So what are the major causes of these ataxia? So if it is acute ataxia, if it's acute, let us learn about each of them separately, so that I'll write it separately because it won't be sufficient here. So in acute ataxia, which occurs from hours to days, number one, the major causes of acute ataxia is intoxication. This intoxication can be due to alcohol or lithium or phenytoin, barbiturates. Okay, though all these will cause acute cerebellar ataxia, and sometimes exposure to mercury also, mercury or bismuth. These are the causes of acute. We don't include mercury and bismuth here, only alcohol, lithium, phenytoin and barbiturates. Okay, so these are acute. And then these can be reversible, because once you remove them, so removing or detoxification, on detoxification, ataxia is suppressed. So this is about intoxication, which is reversible. The second one is whenever there is acute viral cerebellitis, cerebellar infection due to virus. So what are the viruses which occur, which leads to these? They are polio virus, Coxsackie virus, and echo virus, and Epstein-Barr virus, toxoplasmosis, and then Legionella and Lyme's disease. So these are the diseases which are seen in acute viral cerebellitis. Sometimes this also occurs due to post-infection syndrome. This occurs in varicella, mostly after varicella. Here the patient develops gait ataxia and dysarthria, and this is reversible. Okay, so these are the major causes of acute symmetric and progressive cerebellar ataxia. Now let us learn about the second one, which is subacute symmetric and progressive cerebellar ataxia. In subacute, it can be due to, number one, intoxication again, but here the metals include mercury, bismuth, gasoline, glue and others, and it is also caused by drugs like cytotoxic, chemotherapeutic drugs, and it can be due to hemotherapeutic drugs. So these are reversible. Intoxication and drugs are reversible, right? And the next one, it can be due to alcoholism or malnutrition. That is alcoholism plus malnutrition. That is basically vitamin B1 and B12 deficiency. Both these will cause degeneration of cerebellar vermis. So these are not reversible. And then finally, fourth one, Lyme's disease. So these are the subacute, symmetric and progressive cerebellar ataxia. Now, chronic, symmetric and progressive. In chronic, symmetric and progressive cerebellar atrophy, it shows, number one, paraneoplastic syndrome. In paraneoplastic syndrome, for example, breast and ovarian cancers, these produce an antibody which is anti-Yo, whereas Hodgkin's disease, it produces an antibody which is anti-TR. And then small cell lung cancer, it produces an antibody which is anti-PQ type of voltage-gated calcium channels. So these three channels, these three antibodies will combinedly, if you see, they will destroy cerebellum, or they will act on cerebellum, resulting in cerebellar ataxia. Right? So these are the things which are seen in chronic, symmetric, progressive cerebellar ataxia. Number one, paraneoplastic syndrome. Number two, whenever there is anti-gliadin antibody syndrome. In anti-gliadin antibody syndrome, there is increased anti-gliadin antibodies, even this will damage cerebellum. Right, this is one. And the third one is, along with anti-gliadin, sometimes anti-endomycium antibodies, and also fourth one, human leukocyte antigen DQB10201 haplotype. This is also associated with this. Okay, and then there is also some of the inherited diseases, like inherited diseases are associated with this. This is fifth one. And then Tabes dorsalis or tertiary syphilis. Even this is associated with this. And the seventh one is phenytoin toxicity and amiodarone toxicity. So all these will cause symmetric progressive cerebellar ataxia, that is chronic one. And sometimes hypothyroidism also causes this chronic symmetric cerebellar ataxia, right? So let us now learn about the second type, which we have seen, which is focal and ipsilateral cerebellar signs. So this is majorly of three types. One, subacute, that is from hours to days, acute for hours to days, then subacute for days to weeks, and then chronic. So in acute, we have vascular causes, which include cerebellar infarction, then hemorrhage, then subdural hematoma. Because in this there is only infarction at certain place, so that thus there is a particular place, so the neurons which are involved to that place are affected, thus there is focal lesion, subacute hematoma, and infections, that is cerebellar abscess. Because cerebellar abscess is also pertaining to only one particular focal, it is a focal lesion, so obviously it causes focal signs, right? That is subacute. Then that is acute. Now subacute, the causes include, it can be neoplastic. In neoplastic, it can be cerebellar glioma or metastatic tumor. Then the other type is demyelinating disorder. In demyelinating disorder, it can be multiple sclerosis. In multiple sclerosis, there is focal cerebellar signs. And then there is AIDS-related multifocal leukoencephalopathy. This is one more type, right? And then lymphoma. Okay, now chronic. In chronic, it is from months to years, and this involves, number one, stable gliosis, which is formed secondary to vascular or demyelinating disorder. After complete cure of these diseases, of these disorders, there may be development of gliosis, which causes focal cerebellar lesions. That is one. And there is second one, which is congenital lesion. In congenital lesion, we should think about Chiari or Dander-Walker malformation. So these are the different causes of cerebellar lesions, that is cerebellar ataxia. So, in our next class, we will learn about the inherited ataxias. Thank you guys for watching my lecture. If you have any doubts, please comment it in the comment section. If you feel something is inadequate in this lecture, even then, comment it in the comment section. Thank you guys for watching my lecture. Thank you.